Welcome back to our study of the Gospel of John, and I'm excited to continue in our study. Let's go ahead and begin this section with the review of the purpose of John. Remember, he says in John chapter 20 and 30 and 31, many other miraculous signs Jesus did in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life in his name. And now, when we think about that statement, many of the signs Jesus did in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, if you have your Bible open, look over at chapter 21. And notice what he says. These are the very last verses of John. He says, Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. You know, John is using hyperbole there, but what he's suggesting is in our illustration of scene select, John is saying, you understand, I didn't just push play and kind of write down the life of Jesus. My purpose is that you would have life in his name. And John says, and I understand. The only way you can have life in his name is you've got to be able to believe him. So I'm going to present Jesus in a way, John says, that brought him to belief and can also bring us to belief. So, you know, what is that way? Well, you remember we noticed John doesn't use parables, so that's significant. The other Gospels do, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the ones that are referred to as the synoptics, the same view Gospels, but John doesn't use parables. We also note that John doesn't make use the same way as Matthew and Luke, for instance, of the long sermons, like the Sermon on the Mount. But what John does is he uses kind of these three overlapping approaches in literary style. One is he uses these kind of these seven unique signs, these miraculous signs. So it's the turning the water to wine, if you remember, and the healing of the royal official's son, the healing of the man at the pool of Bethesda, and the feeding of the 5,000, and so on. And six of those seven are only found in John. So he's definitely seeking to do something unique, right? We also noted that throughout the Gospel of John, if you were reading it in the language in which it was originally written, in a first century Koine Greek, there are many times that Jesus speaks of himself as, I am this, I am this, I am this. But there are seven unique ones that are structured in such a way that they're meant to be noticed as a set. These are the ones that are like, I'm the bread of life, I'm the light of the world, I'm the resurrection and the life, I'm the vine, I'm the good shepherd, and I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I'm the door of the sheep. So these seven self-revelations of Jesus, these seven key descriptions. And remember, for a first century audience, it wasn't lost on Jesus's listeners that he was using a phrase that evoked the thoughts of Exodus 3 and verse 14, where God said to Moses, tell them I am has sent you. That's why we refer to God, as we mentioned, as the great I am. And Jesus is recorded in John as using that phrase specifically to describe himself. And if you remember, that really stirred up the people. In fact, that contributed eventually to Jesus being rounded up, put on trial, and being killed. So it's a very provocative use of language. The third literary element, along with the signs, the I am statements, is that John uses conversations, personal interactions, to display the teachings and the personhood of Jesus. So we mentioned that Jesus might say something like, in another gospel, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. This is in Matthew chapter 5. But we notice then in John chapter 4 that Jesus is merciful to this woman who's had these five wrecked marriages. So nowhere in John does it actually say, be merciful, so you obtain mercy. It just shows Jesus being merciful. Remember, it says, Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. You know, the humble of heart, that's nowhere in John. But he is the one who washes the disciples' feet. So this review kind of brings us up to speed with our next segment here in the Gospel of John. And that is that in the Gospel of John, you notice that his audience is continually referenced through the way that he interprets geographic signals, the way that he talks about cultural things. He describes Jewish feasts, these religious practices. All of these things would have been known to Jewish people, but not to John's audience, apparently. We noted that you wouldn't have to say to a person born and raised in the United States of America, hey, we're coming up on the American holiday of July 1st or July 4th. You know, we wouldn't have to say that. You can just say to people, it's Independence Day, it's July 4th. You don't have to explain that it's an American holiday, unless you're speaking to people that aren't from America. See, so John continually refers to the, over 70 times he uses the word Jewish or Jew. He's constantly talking about Jewish things to people who apparently are not in a primarily Jewish audience. Now, John is Jewish. It's not like John doesn't know what he's talking about, but it gives us clues to his audience. So one of the things that I'd like you to think about with me for just a few moments are a few examples of this, okay? You'll note, if you're looking for these clues in John, you'll notice that he starts out with some linguistic clues. Chapter 1 and verse 38, he translates the Jewish word rabbi as teacher. That's a clue about his audience not being primarily Jewish. He translates the Jewish word Messiah into the Greek word Christ. He translates Peter's name, Cephas, into the word Peter, which would have been more known for his audience. He talks about culture in explaining what the Passover is. No Jewish person would need an explanation of the Passover. In chapter 4, if you remember, he describes the animosity between the Samaritans and the Jews. Everyone would know that. That would be of absolutely no surprise. To audiences maybe in the early 21st century, maybe they would think back of the example of the Rwandan genocide. No one would have to explain to Rwandans that the Tutsis and the Hutus had this problem. But outside of Rwanda, people may have to explain that. You see, these are the ways we can interpret the clues in the Gospel of John. You'll notice, for instance, he'll do things like several times, I think three, in the Gospel of John, he calls the Sea of Galilee the Sea of Tiberias. Well, Tiberias is a Roman designation for the Sea of Galilee. He grew up on that sea. He was a professional fisherman on that sea. So it's not like John doesn't know what it's called, but outside of Israel, it would have been known as the Sea of Tiberias. That's how people of a non-Jewish or people that were not living in Israel would have thought of that designation. We also note some other pretty subtle things in the Gospel of John that are nonetheless significant. Like, for instance, he makes these references for that we might think, like in chapter 11, verses 48 and 50, it's an interesting reference because the passage references Rome as the occupying overlords of Israel. Now think about this. By talking about the way that Rome was an overlord of Israel, the people in Ephesus and that region could have definitely connected with John. Definitely. Why? Because Ephesus too had been a Greek city, which was now under Roman domination. Now, they were a city of great significance. But when you read in Acts the description of the beginning of the church in Ephesus, you'll notice that there was a riot, and one of the concerns was that the officials above them, which would have been the Romans, would hear of this riot and take away the privileges of their city. So they could have connected with that. I think that's important to note. We also note some insight about this. In John chapter 18, during the trial, verses 28, verses 31, verses 39 to 40, there are several things that happen across the line in the trial of Jesus that every Jew would have understood, you know, whether or not a Jewish person could be prepared for the Passover if they had contact with a Gentile person. When you read those passages, you will pick up on continuing clues that John's audience is primarily Gentile. So I think these are important things to notice. So there's a couple of things we want to note. John's description of Jesus starts with his ministry in Israel. It shows him going back and forth from Galilee to Judea, Judea to Galilee. The dating for that, if you remember from our earlier lecture, is 27 to 30 AD. Obviously, from history's point of view, John's later life is lived out over in the region of Ephesus, modern-day Western Turkey, maybe 600 or 700 miles from Israel. So his audience is separated in many ways, chronologically, geographically, culturally, and religiously. And we need to remember that as we begin this next section. Now, as we start the next section, what I'd kind of like to do is I'd ask you to turn, if you would, to John chapter 1. I want you to turn over to John chapter 1, and we're going to look specifically at the beginning of this gospel. So turn to John 1 with me, if you would, and I'd like us to look at this. We're actually going to read John chapter 1. We're going to begin this study, and you'll notice that this section I have entitled John, and Jesus. John, and Jesus. Now, why is that? Well, the main characters that you'll notice in that we would look at in John's gospel, of course, not as a part of the action so much, would be the writer, John the Apostle. But another key component in this gospel would be, who is John the Baptist? So let me clarify this. John the Apostle, who wrote the Gospel of John, is not John the Baptist. Okay? These are two different people. Both have the same first name, but they're two different people. Jesus is also the main character. And what we're going to notice in the first section of the Gospel of John is that there is a terrific amount of attention given by John the Apostle to the differentiation between John the Baptist and Jesus as the Messiah. So let's talk about why this was the case. We're going to begin by reading John chapter 1, verses 1 through 51. Have your Bible open. I'm going to read the entire reading, and I'd ask you to follow along. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not understood it. Now there came a man sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet, to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave them the right to become children of God, children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and dwelled among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Now John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying this, This is he of whom I said, he who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. Well, from him, from the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, He has made Him known. Now, this was John's testimony. Now, this is John the Baptist. This is John's testimony when the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." Well, they asked him, "Well, then, who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Well, finally they said, "Well, who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the desert, 'Make straight the path for the Lord.'" Well, now some of the Pharisees who'd been sent questioned him, "Well then, why do you baptize if you're not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "Well, I baptize with water," John replied, "but one among you stands who you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." Well, this all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Well, the next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, this is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' See, I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was so that he might be revealed to Israel." So then John gave this testimony, "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me. The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God." The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples when he saw Jesus passing by, and he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." Well, when the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus looked at them following and said, "Well, what do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," Jesus replied, "and you'll see." Well, so they went and saw where he was staying, and they went to stay with him that day, and it was about the 10th hour, and that would be about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said, who had followed Jesus. And so the first thing that Andrew did was to go find his brother Simon and tell him, "We found the Messiah," that is, the Christ. Well, he brought him to Jesus, and Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," which when translated is Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee, and finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. So Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. So when Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Now here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. And Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." And Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus said, "You believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree. You will see greater things than these." He then added, "I tell you the truth, that you shall see heaven open and the angel of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Now, this is a fascinating passage to me, and by many's resolve, One of the most fascinating passages in Scripture. But I want you to think about something interesting. Let's go back to verses 1 through 18, and I want you to consider something with me. What if we read verses 1, 14, and 17 without any of the rest of the verses? 1, 14, and 17. Let's do it. Okay? Ready? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. For the law came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. See, if we just had those three verses, what would it say? It would give the doctrine of the Son of God. This passage is unapologetically powerful. Some have suggested it's one of the most profound statements ever written in language. We'll actually look at that in our next section. So if we had just those three verses, what would it say? In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, He was in the beginning with God. And then what happened? The Word became flesh, dwelt among us. We beheld His glory as the one and only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. And who is it? Well, the law came through Moses, but that grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. So, the Word is God, the Word became flesh, the Word is Jesus. Okay. Interestingly enough, those are only three verses out of 51 in chapter 1. Why does John do this? Now, before we move on from this, I want to try to put this in the context of the Gospels. When we hear the birth story of Jesus in Matthew, chapter 1 and verse 18, it says, you know, the birth of Jesus came about like this. Remember, it says that you'll call Him Emmanuel, which means God with us. That's enough for Matthew, but it isn't enough for John. So let's explore this in John. So look with me at a couple of passages of Scripture. If we think about John the Apostle, one of the things that we've heard historically is there are witnesses that put John in Ephesus. Historic witnesses, people like Justin Martyr, witnesses like Irenaeus. They actually write and say that John lived in Ephesus, wrote and encouraged in Ephesus. But he wrote from Ephesus. And these are witnesses from very early on in history. In fact, in Irenaeus' case, a disciple of Polycarp, who was a personal disciple of John. So upon their witness, and at the beginning of the book of Revelation, John says that he received the revelation while in Patmos, the Roman prison island colony, just off the coast of present-day modern Turkey, just off the coast of where Ephesus is. So there's not really any serious question that John lived out the later part of his life in Ephesus, that John wrote from Ephesus, that John was an impacting part of the Ephesian church and the Ephesian community experience. That's not seriously in question, but I want us to take the time to look at how that might impact our understanding of the Gospel of John. So go with me, if you would, and look first at John chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. Now, this is John the Baptist, not John the Apostle. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. Verse 8, ready? He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Look at 1:15. John the Baptist, testifies concerning Jesus. He cries out saying, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. Look with me at chapter 1, 19 through 27. This is where they asked him, who are you? Notice what it says in verse 20. He didn't fail to confess, but he confessed freely. He didn't deny. He did confess. He didn't deny. I am not the Christ. Well, then who are you? You know, Elijah, the prophet, so on and so forth. I'm not any of them. Then why do you baptize? What is his answer? I baptize because I'm the one calling out like a voice in the wilderness to make way, make the path straight for the Lord. I baptized to reveal Jesus. In fact, he's the one whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. Then what do we read in 29 to 34? We read the transfer there that specifically states that rather than you thinking that I'm the special one because I baptized Jesus, you need to know I wouldn't even have known his full identity. His full identity, of course, he's related to Jesus. We know this from Matthew and Luke. He's related to Jesus. But what he means is I wouldn't have known his full identity had God not revealed to me his full identity. Then notice with me, if you would, 35 to 42, we see John specifically saying to his disciples, go over to Jesus. Don't follow me now that he's present. Follow him. Why is it so important that John the Apostle takes so much time to explain to his Ephesian audience who is John and who is Jesus, who John is not and who Jesus is? Do you realize this is nowhere else in Scripture? None of this dialogue is anywhere else in Scripture. It's not in Matthew, it's not in Mark, and it's not in Luke. Why? Do you realize that John spends more time discussing John the Baptist's differentiation from Jesus than any of the other gospel writers or all of them combined? Why is this? Well, let's go back and try to connect the dots. First, we know that the Christian writers of the second and third century universally say that John lived in Ephesus. So Justin Martyr is 100 to 165. He says specifically, John, one of the apostles of Christ, the witness who lived with us, that is at Ephesus, Irenaeus, also early second century in Asia Minor, reveals in many of his writings about the apostles John's residence in Asia Minor, modern Western Turkey. He expressly declares that the apostle John wrote his gospel at Ephesus. According to Eusebius, later, 260 to 340, and many other church fathers, we can date the banishment of the Apostle John to the Roman prison colony on the island of Patmos during the reign of the Emperor Domitian, 81 to 96. After Domitian's death, the Apostle John returned to Ephesus, where he lived out his days and died at a ripe old age, perhaps almost 100 years old. We talked about the Johannine corpus, Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and Revelation. All of these are strongly emphasizing that they are written to, and the internal and external evidence, they're written to the Christians in the Ephesian area, Asia Minor. We also know more about the church in Ephesus than any other church in the New Testament. This, to me, is fascinating. The first visit of Paul to Ephesus is recorded in Acts chapter 18. It's followed by the story of Apollos, Priscilla, and Aquila. Paul later on went to Ephesus for a much longer stay, and this is recorded in Acts 19. In fact, it turns out that Paul's longest stay anywhere recorded in the New Testament is Ephesus. He's the one that also, Luke gives us a very detailed and colorful account of the mission work that launches the church and the ongoing work of the church and the close relationship of the church leaders to Paul. So if you remember this, there is a man named Apollos, and you can read his story in Acts 18. The Bible says he's a Jewish man from Alexandria, absolutely brilliant, who, according to Scripture, knows accurately the way of Jesus, but only knows of the baptism of John the Baptist. So he's from Alexandria, Egypt. He's now gone north across the Mediterranean Sea, and he's up in Ephesus. He is baffling people with this witness about Jesus. He's brilliant, he's powerful, he's a great debater, but he knows only the baptism of John. Now, do you find that interesting? That 600 plus miles away from Jerusalem, away from Israel, over in Asia Minor, in Ephesus, the story of John the Baptist had traveled. People were actually baptized in the baptism of John the Baptist in Ephesus. And this was happening long after the ministry of Jesus and long after the death of John the Baptist. People are still baptized in the name of John the Baptist. Now, his baptism is similar to Jesus. It's in water. It's for repentance, forgiveness of sins, so it's similar. But do you find it interesting that in Ephesus, John has disciples baptized in the baptism of John? Well, Apollos is up there preaching, and there's two believers who hear him. This couple, Aquila and Priscilla. When they hear him, they're stunned by how much he knows about Jesus, and then they're equally stunned that he doesn't know about the baptism of Jesus, only the baptism of John the Baptist. So it's recorded in Acts 18 that they take him aside and teach him further about Jesus' baptism. Well, then Apollos goes on to Achaia, which is where the city of Corinth is the leading city. He moves on, and the Apostle Paul comes around and ends up in Ephesus. You can read this in Acts 19. In Acts chapter 19, Paul goes into Ephesus. He finds some disciples, and this is very interesting. He asks the disciples, "Have you received the Holy Spirit?" The disciples in Ephesus say, "We haven't even heard there is a Holy Spirit." Paul's next question is very telling. "Then into what baptism have you been baptized? What baptism did you receive?" They reply, "The baptism of John." Paul says that the baptism of John was actually pointing to the baptism of Jesus. And the Bible says that these disciples in Ephesus were then baptized in the name of Jesus. Now think with me about that. Paul is on his missionary journeys. This is decades after John has been killed, John the Baptist, decades after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. He's out there teaching the gospel, and he comes upon these disciples, and apparently he knew the story of what had happened with Apollos and Priscilla and Aquila, because Paul gets to Ephesus and says, "Hey, have you heard the Spirit about the Spirit?" "Not even heard the Spirit." Paul immediately knows. "Then clearly you didn't hear about the baptism of Jesus." Well, how would he know that? Well, throughout the book of Acts, the receiving of the Holy Spirit is linked in some way to Jesus' baptism, our baptism, okay? So when he asked them if they'd heard of the Holy Spirit and hadn't even heard of the Holy Spirit, he immediately asked, "Then what baptism did you receive?" They say, "John's." He said, "John's was pointing to Jesus," and they're baptized in the name of Jesus. Now, where is John living? Ephesus, some decades later. Where is he writing from and writing to? Ephesus. What does John take almost all of chapter 1 to describe? Who is Jesus? Who is John the Baptist? And how are they different? And how are they different? Well, John is not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. John is not the prophet. Who is John? Why does he baptize? Not so people would follow him, but so they'd follow Jesus. What should you do if you're a disciple of John? You should become a disciple of Jesus. All right, now you say, I'm not convinced. Really? Okay, then go back to John. Look with me at chapter 3, John. Chapter 3, move there with me. When you get to John chapter 3, let's notice this situation. We're going to begin in John 3, and we're going to look at verse 22. John 3 and verse 22. After this, Jesus and his disciples went out to the Judean countryside, where he spent some time with them and baptized. Now John, this is John the Baptist, now John was baptizing at Enon near Salim, because there was plenty of water there and people were constantly coming to him to be baptized. Now this was before John was put in prison. An argument developed between some of John's disciples and a certain Jew over the matter of ceremonial washing. So they came to John and said to him, came to John the Baptist and said to him, Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, you know, the one that you testified about? Well, he is baptizing and everyone is going over to him. To this John replied, a man can receive only what is given him from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said I am not the Christ, but I am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens to him, and his joy is full when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, and it is now complete. Now listen carefully. He must become greater. I must become lesser. The one who comes from above is above all. The one who is from the earth belongs to the earth and speaks as one from the earth. The one who comes from above heaven is above all. He testifies to what he has seen and heard, but no one accepts his testimony. The man who has accepted it has certified that God is truthful. For the one whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for God gives a spirit without limit. The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath is on him. You see, what John reveals, John the Apostle, is that this Ephesian challenge is still present. That just as we learn in Acts chapter 18 and 19, that there was this person there teaching people still the baptism of John, and Paul came through and corrected it with about a dozen disciples. Apparently, this was a persistent problem. That the question is, okay, so who is John the Baptist in this picture of what God is doing? Who is Jesus in this picture of what God is doing? And just as John reveals that there was an argument about it in Jesus' day, maybe there was an argument about it in John's day. That some people are still questioning. So, who is the Messiah? I mean, can you follow John or do you have to follow Jesus? Well, how does John the Apostle record the original events? It records John the Apostle saying, number one, I'm not the light. Jesus is the light. I'm not the one that you're here to follow. I was actually the one who testifies to the one that you need to follow. Why? Why does he surpass me? Because he was before me. What does that mean? Well, that harkens back to John's testimony that in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. And he became flesh, and we beheld his glory as the one and only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Law came through Moses, grace and truth through Jesus Christ. John the Apostle's tying it all together and saying that Jesus is that Word who became flesh and is the Messiah, not John the Baptist. And so he goes to this extensive length to record conversations that Matthew, Mark, and Luke don't even touch. That John says, I'm not the Christ. I'm not the prophet that you're looking for. I'm not greater than Jesus because I baptized him. My baptism points you to him. And just as when we were baptizing in the wilderness, those who were my disciples, I commended them to be his disciples, I'm telling you now, I'm not the bridegroom. He is. I'm just a friend. And as a friend, my joy is complete that he is here. So now, I must become lesser as he becomes greater. A man can only do what God has given him. And what did God give me? To testify to the Messiah. So now, do you follow me or do you follow him? In the words of N.T. Wright, do you take a picture of the signpost? Or do you look at what the signpost points you toward. He doesn't want us to dwell on John the Baptist, as amazing though he is. He calls us to focus on the one to whom we've been pointed, to Jesus. So here is my question for you. First of all, what does it reveal? Well, it does reveal the truth that there is a real audience. John isn't writing fiction, but nor is he writing musings from his journal. John is talking to real people with real questions who need real answers. Who is John? Who is Jesus? If I was following John, I mean, is that enough? Or do I need to become a follower of Jesus? And if I need to become a follower of Jesus, what role does John play in that? Okay? Now here's the next thing I want you to consider. What does John show us? John, the apostle, shows us that when you're sharing the gospel with a specific people, like he is sharing the gospel with a primarily Gentile audience in Western Asia Minor, modern-day Western Turkey, at the end of the first century, real people with real questions needing real answers, John shares the gospel in a way that they can get it. What's one of their questions? Who's John? So what does John the Apostle do? He answers the question, who John the Baptist is, so that they can be pointed to Jesus. So let me ask you this. If you're going to share the gospel of Jesus with someone, do you take the time to listen to them? Do you take the time to hear their real questions? So that when you share the gospel, you can help them discover the real answers? That's what I hope we'll be doing in this class. Thanks for joining us. I look forward to seeing you next time.